Ananta Vaishnava Vrinda Ki, ISKCON Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki, Namacharya Hari Das Thakur Ki, Prem Sagaho Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasati Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Ki, Sri Sri Radha Krishna Gokopina Shama Kunda Radha Kunda Giri Govardhan Ki, Vrindavan Dham Ki, Mathura Dham Ki, Navadvip Dham Ki, Mayapur Dham Ki, Jagannath Puri Dham Ki, Jagannath Swami Ki, Srimad Bhagavatam Class Ki, Nittai Gaura Premanandi. Glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees. Glories to Sri Sri Guru Sri Gauranga. I got my glasses. So this morning we are reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 3, text number 25. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Sarvatrat Meshit Meshi Sarvat Ratmesh. Actually, I cannot read it. I forgot my glasses. So do you want to just read yourselves? I think I can read the rest, but this Sanskrit's a little too small. Someone else would like to read?
Sarvatrameshwaran Diksham.
Vidikta chira vasanam.
Santosham yena kenachit.
Sarvatrameshwaram viksham.
Vidikta chira vasanam.
I forgot I had this. Vaishnavis.
Sarvatra, everywhere, Atma,
for one's true self,
Ishvara,
and for the Supreme Personality of Godhead,
and Viksham,
meditation,
by keeping continuously in view.
Kaivalyam,
solitude.
Anikshitam,
having no fixed residence.
Vivikta chira. Scraps of cloth found in unfrequented places.
Vasanam, wearing.
Santosham,
satisfaction.
Yena, Yena kena chit.
Yena kena chit.
With everything.
With everything.
Sorry, with anything.
With anything.
Translation. One should practice meditation by constantly seeing oneself to be an eternal, cognizant spirit soul, and seeing the Lord to be the absolute controller of everything. To increase one's meditation, one should live in a secluded place and give up all false attachment to one's home and household paraphernalia. Giving up the decorations of the temporary material body, one should dress himself with scraps of cloth found in rejected places or with the bark of trees. In this way, one should learn to be satisfied in any material situation. Srila Prabhupada's purport. Kaivalyam, or living in a secluded place, indicates a place free from material disturbances. Therefore, one should live in the association of Vaishnavas, where the common goal is advancement in Krishna consciousness. Especially in the Kali Yuga, if one tries to remain physically isolated from all others, the result will be degradation or insanity. Anikshitatam means one should not be intoxicated by the ephemeral satisfaction of one's home sweet home, which will vanish at any moment by the unforeseen circumstances produced by one's previous activities. In this age, it is not actually possible to dress in tree bark in modern cities, nor to wear mere scraps of cloth. Previously, human culture accommodated those practices, those practicing tapasya or penances, in the interests of spiritual advancement. In this age, however, the most urgent necessity is for preaching the message of Bhagavad Gita throughout human society. Therefore, it is recommended that Vaishnavas dress with clean and neat cloth, covering the body decently, so that the conditioned soul will not be frightened or repulsed by the severe penances of the Vaishnavas. In the Kali Yuga, the conditioned souls are extremely attached to material sense gratification, and extreme austerities are not appreciated, but are instead considered abominable denials of the flesh. Of course, austerity is required for spiritual advancement, but the practical examples set by Srila Prabhupada in successfully spreading the Krishna consciousness movement was that all material things should be used in to attract people in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, Vaishnavas may at times adopt ordinary dress to serve the higher principles of distributing Krishna consciousness. In any case, one should learn to be satisfied in any material situation so as to prepare for the moment of death. According to Bhagavad Gita, at the time of death, the particular consciousness we have created in this life will carry us to our future situation. Therefore, human life can be seen as a type of practice for successfully fixing one's mind on the absolute truth during the severe trials of death. Omagyatamanandasya jnanjana salakaya chaksuram litam yena tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha. Sri Chaitanya Manobhishtam stapitam yena bhutale swayam rupa gadamayam dadati svavadantika. Panchakalpajubhyastya kripa sindhu bhayivacha patitananam bhavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasudhi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Rama Hare Hare. Well, this is certainly a purport which clearly indicates time, place, and circumstance in regards to spiritual life. Oh, yeah. I was waiting for a translator. I forgot. I'm in England now. You get so used to a translator beside you that when you come to England, you forget. So, yeah. That in time, place, and circumstance, we are given direction on the best way forward in spiritual life. And so, therefore, Srila Prabhupada showed the perfect example for preaching in time, place, and circumstance. It's interesting in this purport that Prabhupada mentioned. Srila Prabhupada made quite a few changes when he started the Hare Krishna movement, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. I remember the first Mayapur festival, I was personally there, and at that time Prabhupada invited his godbrothers to the festival, and they were all given, you know, seats. And after Prabhupada spoke, they were asked to say something, you know. Some gave their appreciation. They were very sincere and loyal to Srila Prabhupada, but there were others who were very critical. And they expressed their concern right openly. And some of the main ones were that in our temples we have mixed male and female living, that our Vaishnavis are given Gayatri mantra. There's a whole list of, you know, of what Prabhupada did which was not done before. And when it came to serving prasadam, Prabhupada asked Malati to serve prasadam to the sannyasis. And there was a few sannyasis that just absolutely rejected this proposal of being served by a woman. And Prabhupada intervened and said, no, she's all right. She's a Vaishnavi. And she would cut her throat for me. Said something like that. And then, just to reinforce, he then said, and I would cut my throat for her. Which is a pretty, you know, pretty powerful statement to the sannyasis of the as godbrothers, that I would cut my throat for her. So in this way he set the pace he said he was very determined and clear about his intentions, that I have a worldwide movement, or I'm starting a worldwide movement, and I have already been to the United States of America, and I have watched the people. Shri Radha Landanishvara Ki Jai. And he said that I've watched the people, and the boys and girls mix freely with each other. And if I make any slight changes to that rule, then no one is going to listen to me. And it was interesting that Krishna consciousness started with us hippies, because as hippies we had already trained ourselves in austerity. Here it's mentioning in this verse that austerity is important in spiritual life. But then again, there is austerity and austerity. You know, there's austerity which is explained here, that that you go off in a solitude place in the forest, and you wear tree bark and completely depend on the Lord for your maintenance by taking the resources around you. This is austerity to the extreme, but it used to be practiced. In this day and age, it's not possible. In our forest, Prabhupada said, is Vrindavan Dham, that is our forest. We can go there and we can spend a few weeks there chanting, reading in Vrindavan, and go on Parikram and visit all the different forests of Vrindavan. That is our forest life. Our other forest is within the cities, where there's the forest of illusion. So we can reside in those forests too and spread Krishna consciousness. But it was interesting that, you know, as hippies we had already rejected society and for what it was worth. We could see that the direction it was going, and what was attempted previously by our parents, who were not happy, even though they had material opulence around them. And so we didn't want to follow the older generation. We wanted to start a new revolution in consciousness. And therefore, you know, the hippie movement was launched. and we became quite renounced, to say the least. Well, in some areas at least. There are other areas where we exceeded the previous generation in sense gratification. But our general mode was that we'll accept the bare necessities around us and not accumulate and not be too detached in regards to our surroundings. The problem with the hippie life is it was the flip side of the coin of material life. There wasn't really much difference, except for the fact that we were just a little bit more austere. But that's austerity in the mode of ignorance or passion. And it didn't really satisfy us either. But at least we were trained in austerity even before coming to Krishna consciousness. And when you think of the austerities, or you may have heard about the austerities that we did in the early days, it was quite extreme. You know, especially the devotees that went to India, you know, they were preaching first in America or in England. But then we went to India, and the whole ethos in India is the extreme to the ethos we have here in the West. everything about it, the culture, the climate, it was just extreme. And we didn't know how to live in India, and we learned the hard way. We would take juices, cold juices with ice in, which, you know, if you go to India, you should, if you want to take a cold juice, never ever put ice in the juice, because that water is usually acceptable for the Indian belly, but not for the Western one. And often, in so many cases, even though we were enthusiastic to help Srila Prabhupada in preaching in India, we often became sick. And I was one of those who I was in Mayapur, and I became so sick that one day Bhavananda, he was a Swami at the time, and he said, go to Calcutta, we don't want any dead bodies around here. Hey, that's a joke. Lighten up. I thought that was quite funny. But that's how it was in those days. We don't want any dead bodies around here, so better go to Calcutta. Yeah. And I went to Calcutta. I only stayed there for 2 weeks. But then I was thinking, well, let me go to Delhi and do some preaching in Delhi. And I stayed with Tejas for some time and preached with him. But the heat, the summer heat, became so extreme. And my body temperature is already very hot, and a slight temperature increase, it affects me very much. I can take any amount of cold weather, but heat I cannot take. And I came one day to Tejas, the temple president, and I said, Tejas, I need to go back to the West. And he said to me, well, who's going to do your service? And he said, until you find someone to do your service, how can you leave? So again, I just tolerated. And one of the other things that, phenomena that we did in those days, is that when we went to India, the temple president in the West would only give us a one-way ticket. So I had a ticket to go to India, but I had nothing to return. And so, you know, I knew that if I was to go to the West without an air ticket, I would have to travel overland. And I couldn't take the heat anymore. It was just so extreme. And then I spoke with the head bhajari, because the temple was on the first floor and the ashram was on the same floor, and Tejas' room was on the first floor. And somehow I had to escape from the temple, and I asked the head bhajari if he could help me one night. So we tied some sheets together, and he lowered me down the balcony. And then he lowered my back down. This is just the beginning. I mean, this story is extreme. I managed to take, I had enough money to take a train to Amritsar. And in Amritsar, they have a temple there, it's called the Golden Temple. And there every day you can take prasadam, it's offered prasad. So I stayed there for about a week. But then I knew I couldn't stay there, you know, forever, so I needed to move on. So the next challenge was going through Pakistan. And in Pakistan, the only thing that I could eat was biscuits and Coca-Cola, because there was no vegetarian food. to get even some vegetables. Well, I couldn't cook it anyway, so, you know, it was so difficult. And then Iran, Afghanistan was a little bit better, and a little bit better was Iran. And I was hitchhiking most of the way. And then when I got to Istanbul in Turkey, I had hepatitis. And I was sent to a hospital for 2 weeks in quarantine. And I was there for 2 weeks. And then one day, the doctor came to diagnose me. And he said, "You're not cured yet. We cannot release you yet. You will have to stay at least another 2 weeks." And I was thinking, well, I am not staying here for another 2 weeks, you know. So that night I escaped from the hospital. I went underneath the reception desk and out the door. And then I phoned my father. I said, "Look, I'm stranded in Istanbul. Please send me a ticket, a train ticket to London." So he did that, and so I took a train ticket to London. By the time I got to Bhaktivedanta Manor, no one could recognize me. I was absolutely, what's the word? Strolled? That's not the word. I was finished. I had nothing left in my body practically. And I was so weak and so hungry. And when I arrived, I simply collapsed. And the devotees took me up to the ashram and looked after me. So this is some glimpse of the austerities in those days. That it's not that we voluntarily accepted them, but there was just the way in which, you know, starting an international movement was. That's how it was. Prabhupada wanted us to preach extensively, give every inch of ourself, every cell of ourself to Krishna. And right or wrong, well, I'm still here. I was also sent to Sweden about 1 year after joining. And that was extreme too. You know, I was distributing on the street in Stockholm every day, and in the winter the temperature was 20 below zero and sometimes even more. I didn't understand the language. I didn't understand the people. But there I was, distributing every day on the street. And I remember those days very clearly. Sometimes I would look at myself and speak to myself, and I would say, "Dearest Shanta, are you crazy?" You know, I severely, intensely questioned what I was doing. I didn't have enough faith to say that I was definitely going to be a Hare Krishna for the rest of my life. So I was still in very early days. Prabhupada said at least 12 years it will take before you don't ask that question: am I going to be a devotee or not? Do I want to be a devotee or not? Do I want to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning or not? Do I want to chant 16 rounds every day or not? Do I want to come out on the street 20 below zero to give out books which I don't even know the language and the people or not? But somehow or other, I must have been sincere, and I continued and continued and continued. In fact, I would even say, because sometimes people ask me, what is your secret? You've been a devotee for 44 years or 45 years. What is your secret? And whenever I'm asked that, I think I come up with the same conclusion. There's two reasons why I'm still a Hare Krishna. One reason is that I've always preached. Prabhupada said there should never be a day when you don't offer Krishna consciousness in some form or another to someone who doesn't have. This is what gives us life and soul and happiness within Krishna consciousness. Preaching is life. Preaching is the essence of everything that we're doing to assist Lord Chaitanya in spreading Krishna consciousness. This is what will give us the highest pleasure, kevala ananda. We may try to, you know, conjure up so many other ideas of how I should be a devotee, but if you really want Sri Sri Gaurinitya's mercy, then they will recognize you and they will take personal interest in you when they see that you're sincere to assist them in spreading Krishna consciousness. So, what was I saying?
Two reasons.
Yeah, you want the second reason, right? I'm not sure if I should tell you. Well, the second reason is what I just mentioned, that I've always preached in difficult circumstances. But if you have a choice to have it easy and become lethargic and be mechanical and ritualistic about your service and your practices, then take the easy road. But if you want to come to the higher heights, higher levels of your sadhana and your Krishna consciousness, then take the not so easy option. This is my experience. And even you don't have to do what we did in the old days. Like Prabhupada saying here, the times have changed. And what was austere back then may not be possible today. So that is an important point that Prabhupada's making. But anyway, besides all that, you're in the heart of London, this is Maya's kingdom. You're right in the heart of Maya all around you. And you have this preaching center. It's not just a temple, it is a preaching center. It's also a devotional hospital because you're bringing young devotees in. It's not like they're ecstatic and well. Usually they're uncertain and they're quite sick. So that's another austerity, to try to lift those up in the higher ranks of Krishna consciousness. So not only to make devotees, but to train them. And you have to live with them. I remember the second day I joined, there was a big fight in the temple. Huge fight. It was between two devotees that had joined about a month before. And it wasn't a small fight either. It was a fight to the finish, almost. And I went to the temple president and I said, "What is this? I came here for love and peace. This is what I get." And he told me at that time, he said, "Don't worry, this is a temple, but it is also a devotional hospital. Don't expect that everyone here is well. They're sick. But they're taking the medicine to get well. Therefore, you have to tolerate and be patient with the devotees around you. And then he said to me, don't worry, something will happen to you too. And I was thinking, well, what could possibly happen to me? I'm an ex-hippie, love and peace and all that. 2 weeks later, something did happen to me. It was not that I had a fight with anyone, but I had a fight with my body. This huge boil, never to be seen again. Huge it was absolutely huge. Came up on my left hand, and I still have a scar right there to prove. And I came running to the temple president, and I said, what's this? And he said, well, I told you something would happen to you. And he said, don't worry. You know, your body is so contaminated that Krishna is bringing all the contamination to one place. This is Krishna's mercy on you. So this is Krishna consciousness. Sometimes it gets better before it gets worse. Sometimes we have these things coming up in our mind that we're just like, that's me? You know, because some of the things that come up in our mind are outrageous. And you think, well, that's not me, surely. And I was reading one verse not so long ago in the Bhagavatam, I forget where it is now, but it was making the point that Krishna helps the devotee by bringing up from the recesses of the heart and mind the things that you would have done in the future if you weren't a devotee, and he brings them up to the level of the mind so that you don't have to carry out the activities physically, but they'll hover on the mind for some time too. And this is the reaction. It's a kind of a token reaction to what you could have had if you had not become a devotee. Welcome to Krishna consciousness. It is a fight. Anyone who says it's not a fight, or anyone who's not fighting, they're not rightly situated in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, many devotees don't want to even come up to transcendence. They've reached the mode of goodness, and they're pretty okay with that. Because actually, even that, it's quite an endeavor to come from ignorance, passion, to goodness. And this is what Krishna consciousness does. But Krishna says, don't stop there. You've got to rise to nistraigunya, pure goodness. But there's a segment of devotees who, they get to goodness and they think, that's it. This is where I stay. And they don't want to aspire for a higher heights. So things in the mode of goodness. Mention some things in the mode of goodness.
Qualities.
Not qualities, but activities.
Early rise.
Huh?
Early rise.
Okay, early rise.
Servant.
Some definite qualities of the mode of goodness.
Healthy diet.
I'll be healthy. I'll be a vegetarian and healthy. Regarding offering, sometimes I'll do it, sometimes I don't. Let's check out in London where the vegetarian restaurants are. You know, I don't want to cook today, but I'm a vegetarian. What's the problem? So you go into the vegetarian and you order your meal. Do you bring your pitchers with you? Well, even if you did, Krishna would probably throw it back in your face. Because it's not cooked by a devotee. So this is one good point. Yeah, and a lot of good to be healthier. Because the thing with prasadam is that it's not just healthy. We're not just feeding the belly and giving nutrition to the body, but we're also feeding the soul. Every morsel of food is non-different than Krishna. And for many of us, we came to Krishna consciousness first by taking prasadam. I know I did. 3 months, I wouldn't do anything but take the Sunday feast. And when they saw my interest to eat, take prasadam, they said, well, why don't you come every day? And I said, well, why not? So I came every day just to take prasadam. And then after 3 months, suddenly one day I was on top deck of the bus, and Krishna induced me to chant. I was minding my own business. I had no inclination to chant, but suddenly out of the blue, it was as if Krishna personally jumped on my tongue and forced me to say Hare Krishna. And once I started, that evening I couldn't stop. And I came to the temple the next day and I asked the devotees, you know, I have a problem, can you help me? They said, well, what is your problem? I said, well, I keep chanting your mantra. And they laughed. And one devotee said, do you realize what you've been eating the last 3 months? Good food. And he said, prasad is Krishna and Krishna is prasadam. You've had so much prasad. You have purified your tongue. And now Krishna is personally dancing on your tongue and forcing you to chant. That's how I became a devotee. And you probably have your stories too. So, these are our austerities. We rise early, we chant 16 rounds, and we take prasadam. We go to the holy dham. We help assist in the preaching. This is enough. It's sufficient. We don't have to go and excel that. One time a devotee did, he wanted to go to Radhakund. And he said, Prabhupada, can you bless me to go to Radhakund to chant 64 rounds? And Prabhupada said, no, there are already so many monkeys there, we don't want another one. And another devotee, he had learned the whole of Bhagavad Gita, and he was introduced to Prabhupada. Prabhupada, here is the first disciple of yours who has memorized the whole Bhagavad Gita. Prabhupada didn't even look at him. He just said to the servant, well, make sure that he's engaged in some service while here in Vrindavan. So he didn't even want us to be academically qualified, you know, to the extent that we would be proud and arrogant and look down on the other devotees. But he wanted us to assist him in this preaching movement. That preaching means bothering others. You know, if you're not bothering others, you're not preaching. Because you have to bother them. They're hell-bent and going to hell. They're going to the direction where there's no return. It's to hell. Well, they may pop up back to the human form of life every so often. But why should we let them go to hell? So we have to stop them. So even stopping them, stop. Oh, excuse me, sir. Would you mind taking one of these books? Isn't it like that? Who's a book distributor here? You? Isn't it? Just stopping them. It is a major feat.
The hardest beat.
Huh?
The hardest beat to stop them. The hardest beat is to stop them.
Yeah.
Anyway, there are some verses here which I want to read. This is in the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. But there's one verse I wanted to read first. Yeah, Arjuna is asking, what are the symptoms of one whose consciousness is thus merged in transcendence? How does he speak, and what is his language? How does he sit, and how does he walk? So these are some of the answers that Krishna gives. Krishna says, when your mind is no longer disturbed by the flowery language of the Vedas, and when it remains fixed in transcendence of the trance of the self, then you will have attained the divine consciousness. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, O Partha, when a man gives up all varieties of desires for sense gratification, which arise from mental concoction, and when his mind is thus purified, finds satisfaction in the self alone, then he is said to be in pure transcendental consciousness. One who is not disturbed in mind, even amidst the threefold miseries, or elated when there is happiness, and who is free from attachment, fear, and anger, is called a sage of steady mind. In the material world, one who is unaffected by whatever good or evil he may obtain neither praises it nor despises it is firmly fixed in perfect knowledge. One who is able to withdraw his senses from the senses, sense objects, as the tortoise withdraws the limbs within the shell, is firmly fixed in perfect consciousness. And the last one who restrains his senses, keeping them under full control, and fixes his consciousness upon me, is known as a man of steady intelligence. So the devotee is not even affected by the environment around him. I remember some years ago I was here, and I stayed for about a week, and I think I wasn't able to take the sannyas room for some reason. Someone else was there, but I was staying in the brahmachari ashram, and I just couldn't sleep. And I asked the devotees, "How do you sleep at night here?" And they said to me, "Well, fine, what's the problem?" I said, "Well, don't you hear the noise outside?" And one devotee said, "What noise?" And I could understand, this is transcendence. That the devotees are so absorbed in their service to Krishna, they don't even acknowledge what's going on outside. It's another world, it's another distance. They're in the spiritual world enjoying their service and relationship with Krishna. So even though it's the center of London, and there's every reason to be affected by the environment around us, devotees who have captured transcendence are not affected. I'm just giving an example like a lotus flower. It's born in the mud, but it flowers above the water. The devotees, if they're chanting their 16 rounds every day, they will transcend those modes and be transcendentally situated. There was one man who, he went to a sadhu one day, he was complaining, you know, In the place where I live, the environment is terrible. It is so materialistic that this environment is rubbing off on me. Please help me. So the sadhu, he took the man for a walk in the park. And in the first area of the park, there were some men who were mixing manure. And the man who complained, he got his handkerchief and he held his nose because the manure smell was so strong. And then they went, and he looked up to the sadhu, but the sadhu was just walking and he smiles and is smiling. And they went to another part of the park where there were some flowers, scented flowers. And the man, he took away his handkerchief and he smelled the aroma of the flowers within the park. And then he looked up to the sadhu and the sadhu was still smiling. And he was wondering, what is it with this sadhu? I came to him with a problem and all he does is take me to the park for a walk. So he was intrigued and he was thinking that maybe he's making fun of me or something. So he said, why have you brought me to this park? I came with a problem and you, so far you have not helped me with my problem. So then the sadhu, he said, yes, he said, I'm not smiling at you. I find it very hilarious that in this present day and age where everything is so easily available, there is material comfort and there are resources around us that make our life so easy. You're even getting your food from far distant countries. Well, whether that's good or bad, that's another question. But the availability to get, mangoes and whatever, fruits that don't grow here, it is available there in Tesco's and other places, right? He said, but when there's the slightest inconvenience, then the first thing you do is complain. He said, you smelt the food that was offered to these plants. You smelt it and you couldn't take it. It was so terrible that you held your nose. But that very manure was used by the plant to create scented flowers. He said, in the same way, if you're practicing sincerely your spiritual responsibilities on a day-to-day basis, you'll transcend the atmosphere around you. And not only transcend it, but you will have the ability to make it sweeter. This is why we're here in the heart of London. I have seen through the years of being a devotee how Krishna consciousness has helped society. It is so obvious to me. When I used to go on Oxford Street, if I told someone I was a vegetarian, they would look at me as if I was coming from another universe. Nowadays, the vegetarian society is the fastest growing society in London. Is it not? If you mentioned words like yoga, meditation, eyebrows would rise. Now it's common, very common amongst the society of non-devotees, meditation, yoga, karma, reincarnation. Oh, I don't want to do that, that will give me some bad karma. This is amazing. And they even make films like Avatar. Who ever heard of Avatar before Prabhupada? Srimad Bhagavatam. And then words like bliss, nectar, they weren't even used, they were in the dictionary, but no one ever used them. What's bliss? What is nectar? It was completely out of their not within their vocabulary of life. But now they got nectar cards and bliss bars. This is just the beginning. You wait till we get going. Yeah? So, you're living a transcendental life. There is no question of that. Be happy. Don't be complacent. And you're in service to Krishna. Don't see it as an inconvenience to follow these practices and principles. Because this is the tendency. This can be the tendency. Like, I will give you an example. Could you pass me my beads here? I will give you one example of a particular attitude which is not correct. A demonstration. It is in the mood of, I have to do this, I don't want to do it, there's hundreds, I have a list of 100 things that I could probably better do than have to do this. How boring. It's a boring day and it's 16 rounds all the way. Here's the opposite. Not that I have to chant, but I want to chant. You can even stick your little finger out. You know how the aristocrats, when they hold a cup, they stick their finger out like this. It's aristocratic chanter. You can stick your finger out if you like. You're an aristocrat of the holy name. Back straight. Posture is very important. If you have a bent back, you have a bent mind, Prabhupada said. Demonstration. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Is there a difference? Is there a difference? Yes or no?
Yes.
What is the difference? The attitude. Who said that? You. The attitude is different. And this is what actually I did. Because it comes a point in your japa where you think, oh, this is terrible. I've been going like this for years. I've got to make a change. In order to bring your japa up to another level, you need to change your attitude about chanting. And this is what I did. And when I made that change, I started to experience the nectar of the holy name like I'd never experienced before. So it's not that Krishna consciousness is so difficult, because, I mean, if you like, you can stand on one leg for 1,000 years, like they used to do in Satya Yuga. It's your choice. But I guarantee you won't last 5 minutes. So what are you going to do? Stand on one leg? Do a Hiranyakashipu austerity? Even he performed austerity for sense gratification. So what to speak of us who are devotees? Prabhupada said, if you see a non-devotee more enthusiastically serving Maya than you are to serve Krishna, you should get up immediately past that person and enthusiastically serve Krishna. This is the proper attitude. There is nothing that's not within our grasp, because we have Krishna, and Krishna will arrange everything for us. He wants the world to change. He's personally come here to inaugurate the Sankirtan movement. It is his desire. It is not even our desire, it's his desire, so surely he will help. If he sees that his devotees are assisting him. And this is what I've experienced over the years. I've seen the world changed. We have made an effort to please Sri Sri Gaur-Nitai, and they're assisting with this effort, and they're changing the world. How they will change it completely, that is going to be very, very mystical. But we have seen even Prabhupada's endeavor was also very, very mystical. So we can for sure expect more mysticism in Krishna consciousness. It will change. And Prabhupada even made the point it will change. Krishna consciousness will change the world in their darkest hour of material enjoyment. So how that's going to happen, the only thing we can understand is that it'll happen through the Sankirtan movement. So it makes sense that we just assist, do what we can to help and watch the change take place. And see the world change for the better, and that we liberate these towns, send them to the Vaikuntha or back home, back to Godhead. Because Prabhupada said that when he was asked, why do we have overpopulation? And usually he would say, well, I'm looking from my plane window, I don't see that there's overpopulation. So much land which is not being used. So it's mismanaged and you're all living in the city. But in this particular time, when someone asked, he said, yes, there is overpopulation. There's overpopulation because no one's going back home, back to Godhead. He said, there's no upward mobility. The system's jammed up. Therefore, we are presenting Krishna consciousness to the world to give facility for people to go back home, back to Godhead. This is Krishna consciousness. And we are the ones that are going to assist, and we are the ones that are going to benefit from that more than anyone. So I'll stop there. Srila Prabhupada ki. Sri Sri Gaur-Nitai ki. Srimad Bhagavatam class ki. Gaura Prahimananda Hari Hari.
Thank you very much, Maharaj. Okay, now we will read, as usual, Sankirtan's course from yesterday. So starting with our shop, Closet Krishna, in Rochester, in Kent, we distributed yesterday 4 medium books and 1 big book and collected 147 Lakshmi points. Hari Bol. And in Radha's boutique yesterday 18 books was distributed and collected, Radha's boutique collected 228 Lakshmi points. Hari Bol. And on Street Sankirtan, 5 scores were submitted. Starting with Bhakti Gamya, she